Thank you. This morning we remember and honour the life of Percy Joseph Anderson, whom we all know as Percy. Remember with Esther, Annette and Jeff, Susan and Robert, Rodney and Wendy, his grandchildren, Braden, Joseph, Daniel, Unique, Israel, Brianna and Jalen, with Bill and Jean, his brother and sister, with other family members and the friends from the many organisations of which both Percy and Esther have been involved. Particularly the bowls, the swimming, and of course, basketball. But I'm told there are very many other sporting activities that both have been involved in over the years, including rugby league, cricket, badminton, and athletics.
As many connections and as many friends
that are with us this morning. And we pray. Lord of all gentleness, surround us with your care and comfort Percy's family and friends in their sorrow as they grieve his death. Listen to our prayers for your son, Percy, and lead him gently home to heaven. May we one day be united again and share together the joy of your kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite Annette, Susan and Rodney to come forward to deliver the eulogy. Placing a number of symbols which reflect various parts and interests of Percy's life.
Percy Joseph Anderson was born May 1944 in Townsville to parents William Anderson and Alethea Lewis, Bill and Lil. He became little brother to Bill Jr. and then big brother to Jean. Grandparents Will and Jane Anderson lived next door in Latchford Street, Pimlico, while his other set of grandparents, Alf and Rose Lewis, lived in Garoo. Apart from a short time due to his dad's railway transfer to Alpha and a 6-month sea change on Magnetic Island when very young, Dad lived his whole life in Townsville. The family had a hut at the Horton where lots of fishing and crabbing was done. Dad was baptised and went to primary school at Blessed Oliver Plunkett's Catholic Church in Mundingburra and was an altar boy there. This is now where St Joseph's School and Holy Trinity Church are. Dad later went to St John Fisher's, then Our Lady's Mount, where he finished junior in 1959. Dad sat at the school exam, the external exams, at the end of year 10, and his results showed he was one of the top students in Queensland. Grandma used to say he'd come home from school and study hard by copying out all notes from school that day again in another notebook. Despite getting top marks and being encouraged by all and sundry to continue on to senior schooling, Dad put his foot down and said he wanted to be an electrician. He was always pulling household appliances apart and then, mostly, putting them back together. Whilst at school, Dad won many ribbons and trophies for running at Townsville and NQ level. He was a Townsville A-grade tennis champion, table tennis champion, and was in the Army Cadets and played rugby league at school. In 1959, Dad was indentured to Queensland Rail as an electrical fitter apprentice. He did this at night while working during the day at the railway and achieved distinctions and credits in all subjects, once again being encouraged to do further studies in engineering, but he was more than happy with what he was doing. One of his first jobs when he finished his apprenticeship was to rewire the wagon wheel machiner from diesel power to electricity. That same machine was still in operation over in the South Yards up until they closed a few years ago. It was through working on the Inlander train to Mount Isa that Dad met his first and only girlfriend in 1966, who he later married. The love of his life, our mum, Esther Clough. Mum worked for Queensland Rail in the refreshment rooms and on the trains in the dining cars. Dad asked Mum to go out with him to the movies on the day of his grandmother's funeral in 1966, while he was hobbling along on crutches from a sporting injury. So Mum took pity on him and went out with him, but she liked him from the first day she saw him anyway. The rest is history, and they were married at Holy Trinity Church, Munningborough in March 1968, just over 53 years ago. Best man and groomsman were Dad's brother Bill, lifelong friend Ray Hoare, and Mum's nieces Kim and Karen as lovely little flower girls. Dad and Mum lived with Mum's parents for a while in West End while their house in Railway Estate was being built, a nice high-set house with four bedrooms for the family they planned. Along came Annette, known to Dad as Annie, Susan, known as Susie, and Rodney, known as Rodney. Or the golden haired child.
Right.
Or the golden haired child. Dad was known to us as God, good old Dad. Dad and Mum became involved in the children's sports. Dad was still playing basketball for Black Stars and coached some boys' teams while Annette and Susan were playing for their teams. Dad was always really proud to tell people that rugby league player Gene Miles credited his famous passes to his basketball days, and that Dad was the one who taught him to play basketball and was his coach. Once Dad thought his playing days were over with basketball, he moved to refereeing. His claim to fame was that the final game he refereed was an NBL game, so he retired at the top. Dad also coached Rodney's team for many years. With a love of basketball so great, this was not the end. He then moved onto the score bench, scoring for the Suns and Crocs games, the State League Heat and Flames for over 25 years, and at a World Championships in Melbourne. Dad spent a lot of time volunteering at basketball, often being called in to fix broken lights, help out with a variety of things, and mow the grass on the road on, etc. He was made a life member of Townsville Basketball Referees Association and Townsville Basketball Incorporated. He was awarded the Suns Basketball Club Person of the Year in 1996 and an Australia Day Award for services to basketball. He gave so much to basketball as a committee member, coach, player referee, scorer, referee coordinator, and passionate supporter.
I'm just trying to make sure I haven't read past my
book. The three children were involved in swimming, and through the many years there helping with timekeeping, marshalling, making dumbbells, etc., Dad and Mum were made life members of Townsville Tourist Swimming Club. Many carnivals in and out of town and club camping trips were held, lots of friends made, and very early mornings taking us to training. Dad excelled at everything he did. It was all done with study or research, precision, and usually a diagram drawn on a scrap of paper. There were lots of sit-down and talks at our house that involved hand-drawn instructions, everything from what to do with money when starting work, learning how to drive, how to referee and where to stand, etc. The famous line, measure twice, cut once, is still well used. Golf was no exception to the excelling rule. Dad loved to play golf, especially in the last few years with his friend Glenn Slatter. Social cricket. The railway had a social club and cricket was one of the pursuits. Playing mostly in Anoomba Primary School, Dad would load up the trailer with eskies, ice, tarps, wickets, bats, pads and more. Mum, Susan and I were the bread butterers, tomato and onion slices. Many great times were held on Sundays at cricket and at the end of year parties at our house with a pig on a spit. I'm pretty sure those who attended still remember those days. They were great and we'll remember them fondly. Dad loved being fit. He would get up early in the mornings and do a fitness routine from a book. He participated in the Bridge to Bay Fun Run twice here in Townsville. It was a 10K run from the Nathan Street Bridge down Ross River and Charters Towers Roads along Flinders Street and finished in front of Anzac Park. He completed the race under his goal of 1 hour. We all loved being there to cheer him on. Dad came from a family of railway employees. His father, grandfather, and brother Bill all worked for Queensland Rail. And after 45 years of service, Dad retired to enjoy time with Mum. He had worked in the electric shed for many years in the North Yard, on the Inlander to Mount Isa, then over to the South Yards, working on something he was very proud of, building the Great South Pacific Express. Dad was a very proud poppy to Braden, Joseph, Brianna, Daniel, Jalen, Yannick, and Israel. He loved playing jokes on them, telling jokes. They were poppy jokes, not dad jokes. Quizzing them on things, picking them up from school. He also had a really good relationship with his son-in-laws, Jeff and Robert, and daughter-in-law, Wendy. Dad was a keen lawn bowler, as was his mum, Lil, and they were at Suburban Bowls Club. He used to say he was never going to bowl, but after Rodney and Mum's brother Vic Clough started playing together, he and Mum eventually joined him too. He was proud of the wins he had in some big competitions and loved umpiring. He was always encouraging of all bowlers, walking up and down, giving tips, etc. One of his proudest moments was when he and Rodney won the North Queensland pennants together in Bowen. Dad loved going on holidays. We had a pop-top caravan, which we had some great Christmases and other travels to Sydney, Canberra, Brisbane, Airlie Beach, and everywhere in between. He'd take lots of photos and 8mm videos. When myself and Robert moved to Canada in the mid-2000s, this encouraged Mum and Dad to travel overseas, and so the travel bug hit. They went to Canada, Las Vegas, Los Angeles, Graceland for Mum, and more, at least twice, and also Vietnam. When Mary MacKillop was canonised in Italy, they were lucky enough to attend that in Rome and go on a bus trip of Italy. Lifelong friends Ray and Margaret Hoare invited them on a cruise to New Zealand, and the cruise bug got a hold. Another two cruises to New Zealand, a cruise around Japan, and one to PNG before their last trip on the infamous Ruby Princess. We used to wonder if Dad liked visiting overseas hospital. Kidney stones hit in both Canada and Vietnam, and according to Dad, it was worse than childbirth. They asked him, out of 10, what was his pain level? Oh my God, it's a 14. Dad and Mum's house in Idalia was inundated with floodwaters in February 2019, like many others were. It was due to Dad's organisational skills, attention to detail, and drive that they had their car replaced immediately and the insurance paid out, and to have a house fully restored and returning to live there by August of that year. No small effort when most people know the struggles and roadblocks a lot of flooded people have had and still have. Dad was infected with COVID on the Ruby Princess in March 2020 and spent 6 weeks testing positive at home and in hospital. He was a star witness at the Royal Inquiry. Mum cared for him at home for the entire time, surprisingly never contracting COVID herself. Dad struggled to regain his health to its pre-COVID days, but still kept busy running around, fixing things, up and down ladders, picking up grandchildren and more. In August 2020, Dad had a cornea replacement and transplant, which didn't quite take at first, so there was quite a bit of to and fro into the hospital clinic, lying tilted backwards on a bed for many days and so on, which wasn't fun for him. These were not the first health issues Dad had over the years. In his mid-30s, he had a melanoma removed, which saved his life due to the keen spotting, quick action, and drastic measures taken by his surgeon, Errol Maguire. Then,
In his 50s, another melanoma was found on his arm, and one on his head in his 60s. Unfortunately, this was not surprising given his father and grandfather both died from melanoma. In January this year, with symptoms of a stroke, he went to the hospital to have a scan to find out that his problems were caused by a metastatic melanoma in the brain. Radiation treatment made Dad really sick and knocked him flat. And his decline from being an extremely active, able-bodied, independent, and capable man was quick and, for him, unbearable. Dad spent over 6 weeks in hospital in the last 3 months. Mum was by his side the entire time, and we're so proud of her. She only slept went to home to sleep at night, and then when he was moved to palliative care, she stayed with him day and night for almost 3 weeks, being a nurse and carer. It is with great sadness that we say goodbye, feeling that we've lost him too young, but knowing that he is no longer miserable and unable to be who he was and be himself. We remember the love, the good times, and all that he has done for us. As Dad said toward the end, he's had a good life and a full life. And I'm going to regret saying to put this in because I've got to be the one to read this now, but one of Dad's last questions was, is it over yet? Well, Dad, it's over now. Your new journey now begins.
Thank you. The family now wishes to share a pictorial reflection of Percy's life.
When you walk through a storm, keep your head up. Don't be afraid of the dark. At the end of the storm is a golden sky and the sweet silver song of a walk on through the wind, walk on through the rain, though your dreams be tossed and blown. Walk on, walk on, with hope in your heart. I love you because you understand, dear.
every single thing I try to do. You're always there to lend a helping hand, dear. I love you most of all because you're you. No matter what the world may say about me, I know your love will always see me through. I love you for the way you never doubt me, but most of all I love you 'cause you're you. I love you because my heart is lighter every time I'm walking by your side. I love you because the future's brighter, the door to happiness you open wide. No matter what the world may say about me, I know your love will always see me through. I love you for 100,000 reasons, but most of all I love you 'cause you're you.
sono solo sogno all'orizzonte e mancano le parole. Sì, lo so che non c'è luce in una stanza quando manca il sole. Se non ci sei tu con me, sì. Le finestre mostrano tutto il mio cuore che è acceso. Chiudi dentro me la luce che ho incontrato per strada.
Sogno all'orizzonte manca le parole. Io sì lo so che sei con me, tu mia luna, tu sei qui con me. Mio sole, tu sei qui con me.
I invite Debbie to come forward for the first reading.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to Timothy. As for me, my life has already been pulled away, and the time has come for me to be gone. I have fought the good fight to the end. I have run the race to the finish. For us, our homeland is in heaven, and from heaven comes our Saviour we have been waiting for, the Lord Jesus Christ. And he will transform these earthly bodies of ours into copies of his own glorious body. For we know that we know that when the tent we live on in earth is folded up, there is a house built for us by God, an everlasting home
not made by human hands in heaven. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples at the Last Supper, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God still and trust in me. There are many rooms in my Father's house. I'm going now to prepare a place for you. After I've gone and prepared you a place, I shall return to take you with me, so that where I am, you may be too. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord.
This time
we reflect on Percy's life. We have heard the story or some of the parts of his life, and we've seen some of the pictorial reflection of who Percy was. But we hear the story of that great love that Percy had for his family. We get the story of the easy connection Percy had with the various groups, organisations that he had part of. Percy shone in all of those places. He shone with the communities he was part of. So reflect this morning on that great Spirit of God that's within us that makes us different, that allows us to do sometimes extraordinary things, as we hear in Percy's life. That great love that we shared with Percy was something that came from within him, that great Spirit of God, that presence of God. But part of that Spirit of God that was in Percy that we all shared and we heard the story of, that Spirit of God also led Percy into part of his faith journey. We hear the early part of his story when he was an altar server as a boy. We know that he went to those various Catholic schools. I knew Percy and Esther through their connection with the Railway Estate Parish for quite some years. Percy and Esther were a team. I anointed Percy some days before his death, and I know in my talking to Percy that he was ready to say goodbye. And he said goodbye to all of us.
He's left a lasting
memory. And his memory and his presence will continue on in his family. That memory of Percy becomes part of all of our lives. That makes a connection with us, that alters in some small way the way that we think about things, the way that we go about things. But we know that for all of us, there is a time. We hear in our scripture readings this morning, there's always a plan for us made by God. It's a plan that none of us are aware of. We don't know what that plan might be. But my understanding of Percy's journey was that he was always ready to meet his God. I heard the story of Percy and Esther. One of Percy's aunts was a Josephite nun, so it probably makes an easy connection for them both going on a pilgrimage to Rome for the canonization of Mary MacKillop. But Esther told me the story that they were on the bus. Our previous Bishop Michael Putney also was on that journey, and they both had this great experience of being present with our Bishop Michael Putney and the stories and the jokes that he told. So for Percy, there was an easiness about his faith and about his life. But we know, as we hear in our scripture readings this morning, that there's always a place prepared for us by God. And at that time, Jesus returns to take us with him, so that where God is, we may be too. And we know for Percy, there is no more pain. There is no difficulty in life, because we know that Percy in the peace and loving hands of his God.
We have some
prayers. I invite Kevin and John to come forward. My dear friends, Jesus tells us, do not let your hearts be troubled or afraid. Trust in God and trust in me. Let us now place our trust in our compassionate God as we pray.
Lord, we thank you for the gift of Percy's life. Welcome Percy now to share in the fullness of your risen life. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for Percy's family. May they be strengthened by the love they share and draw courage from the memory of Percy. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, we give you thanks for the presence and loving support of our friends who have gathered here today. Bless them and sustain them, love, with your love. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for all those who cared for Percy. May they be blessed for their love and care. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We remember all who have died and all our deceased relatives and friends. May they receive the reward of their goodness. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer. Lord God, you offer us hope through your promise of eternal life. Listen with love to the prayers of your people. Be with us in our grief and sorrow.
We make our prayers
through Christ our Lord. Amen. With hope and eternal life, let us pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother Percy. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. You washed Percy in the waters of baptism. Now welcome him into
eternal life.
We use this incense, we reflect on Percy's spirit rising to meet his loving God. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Percy, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will also rise with him. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon Percy in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness, of our companionship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your son Percy, and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith, till we all meet in Christ
and are with you, with my brother Percy,
forever. Because our brother Percy has passed away from this life to the next, we commit his body to the elements from which it was made. For we are dust, and unto dust we shall return. But the Lord Jesus Christ will change our mortal bodies to be like his in glory. He is risen, the firstborn of the dead. So let us commend our brother Percy to the Lord, that the Lord may embrace him in peace and give him everlasting life. Merciful Lord, you know the anguish of the sorrowful. You're attentive to the prayers of the humble. Hear your people who cry out to you in their need and strengthen their hope in your lasting goodness. May the love of God and the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ bless and console us and gently wipe every tear from our eyes. Eternal rest grant unto Percy, O Lord. Let perpetual light shine upon him. May his soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God,
rest in peace. Amen.
I invite all those who wish to form a guard of honour to form up in front of the whatever it is. Where they keep a record of everything, they tell me. So we're going to move then in procession around in front of the guard of honour and round on the outside before we leave the stadium. So invite those who wish to form a guard of honour to form up behind me.